Tech and Blockchain panel. Our moderator today will be David Gary. Our special events tonight include HOTS, the Hungarian Music Export Bureau, which will be presenting Hungarian breakthrough artists Ivan and Parizol, as well as York at Drone. We hope that you enjoy this upcoming presentation, and also please check out the MONDO app for updates and more information regarding upcoming panels and showcases. Thank you.
Hey, good afternoon, everybody. You're welcome, everybody, to come here. Before we started the panel today, we were talking about how the digital economy has obviously helped people find many different ways to make money. And there was a poll that was taken coming in here, and people have talked about things such as TaskRabbit, as well as also Uber.
Discovered is that really almost anything is content. Whether you drive somebody from here to there, that's a piece of content. That's what we mean. Sorry if I went wrong.
No, not at all. In terms of what you're doing is potentially giving people greater control over their content. It'll be interesting to see how your database grows and how you extract value from that. I also wanted to pass on next to Divi Project. And Nick, if you have a chance to talk about where you are and how the company started. You just recently went live last week, so welcome.
Thank you. My name is Nick Zeppanero. I'm the lead full-stack developer and one of the co-founders of the Divi Project, which is a blockchain that was created to increase usability for cryptocurrency and solve a lot of the issues present in cryptocurrency from a user experience standpoint, scalability standpoint, and of course actual usage in the real world. We offer this opportunity to earn Divi by setting up what we call a mochi. At the click of a button, you can deploy what is called a master node, which is essentially a node in the network that keeps a full copy of the blockchain that helps to secure the network and verify transactions. You don't need to necessarily worry too much about how that works because, like I said, it is deployed at the click of a button. It's about as easy as setting up iTunes on your computer. And as a reward for supporting and verifying the network transactions, you are rewarded with more Divi. It's the simplest process that exists today. Traditional masternode setup takes even seasoned developers, 4 hours or more even to accomplish. This enables anyone to start earning cryptocurrency just as easy as it would be to sign up for an Uber or a Lyft, except with us, you don't have to drive people around and worry about them throwing up in the back of your car.
So I was curious, in terms of looking at Divi and looking at your masternodes, I think you said, how many masternodes do you now have up and running within less than a week?
Yeah, so we launched on Thursday, and we now have just about 300 mochis deployed. 60% of our exchange tokens, we started on the Ethereum blockchain, have been transitioned into Divi, which is our own blockchain at this point. So, and we expect a lot more to come online over the next week or two.
Okay. Now, in terms of using the masternodes, how are we actually looking at masternodes being deployed in terms of reducing transaction time?
Can you rephrase that?
In terms of the use of the masternodes, what are the benefits that people are getting in terms of being able to deploy this? What's the scale of transactions that they need to support in order to earn Divi? To what extent is Divi potentially exchangeable into other forms of either cryptocurrency or fiat?
Sure, so the masternodes, if you deploy using the Mochi system, are deployed to a virtual server, which we have configured to be optimal for the network. The thing with proof of stake, which is the consensus algorithm or methodology that that Divi is built on, is it's inherently more efficient than proof of work, which would be Bitcoin's consensus algorithm, because it doesn't require as much energy and it doesn't require a pretty much supercomputer to initiate a node. And for that reason, it makes it much more accessible to the average computer user and the average computer. This strengthens the network, and of course, we have implemented technologies that allow for faster transaction times, lower unspent transaction output, bloat, things like that, which I don't necessarily know if I want to go too deep into right now, but we have a lot of information about that on our website, and if you want to ask me after the panel, I'm happy to go more detail.
So to finish out the introduction for our panel members, Thomas, we have a chance to talk about Sona. If you can give us a background on the company, how long has it been in operation, sort of how things scale for you? What have you learned so far in terms of the operation of the company? What's your next evolution?
Yeah, so Sona is essentially a global computing resource marketplace. And the ICO happened last June. We raised $42 million in 3.5-4 days. And in December, we launched our testnet. And on June 30th, we launched our production mainnet offering. We ran into some problems with the congestion of Ethereum, had to create a sidechain and some things of that nature. But, and we cur- currently just hit a benchmark where we had over 100 simultaneous tasks in the marketplace. We have a lot of enterprise interest at the moment. The technology is built on top of fog computing, which is like a decentralized cloud. We'll get more into that. And so in terms of making money, what happens is participants in the network are either suppliers or consumers. And the suppliers are contributing computing network or computing resources like their laptop, their desktop, could be a mobile phone eventually, and you are getting paid for that. One interesting thing is from the mining, if you have a mining rig, which is what is used for proof of work, the Sonom network, the task bots will default to mining cryptocurrency until there's a task that comes from an enterprise. Then it will switch, execute that task, and then go back to mining cryptocurrency. So you are effectively making money anytime you are enabling your resource on the platform.
Great, thank you. So one of the things, obviously, in terms of any company covered starting off in an operation, and certainly looking in terms of a side hustle, is basically building community. And I'm curious to sort of see, Andrew, with respect to Steam, said in already that you've got about $60 million worth of volume that's going across in terms of value created across your network. What have you been doing in terms of, what's the size of your community now? What are you doing in terms of various forms of outreach? How do you see this developing further from where you are now?
Sure, yeah. Well, just to clarify, our blockchain has distributed $60 million to content creators. The total value of our tokens has ranged anywhere from $200 million to $1 billion, and the daily volume is whatever it is, it's high. Our community, we've got 1 million+ accounts. We've got 60,000 daily active accounts, and these are people posting all kinds of content on all kinds of platforms. There's now over 400 apps running on the Steam blockchain right now. All kinds of businesses are operating on Steam right now, and you know, earning steam by posting content. I mean, I think that I've always felt that we're moving towards an economy where content is really king, right? You sell a shirt, you sell earrings, whatever. What people are really buying is the story that you're telling and the community that you're trying to build. And we're really about community. Right now, we basically have one coin fuels this enormous community, the biggest blockchain community on the planet by orders of magnitude. So, our next product is something called Smart Media Tokens. And what that'll do is enable anybody to launch their own token like ours that is designed to foster community growth, because the community itself is in charge of distributing it, not by firing up a machine, no matter how easy it is, but simply by looking at what somebody produces and upvoting it. And through that upvote, they convey a percentage of new tokens that are being created at a preset rate. It could be 1%, it could be 5%, whatever. But it basically puts control over the printing press in the hands of the community member. And that's how you foster community growth on the internet. We think that's our premise.
Sure. Have you gotten, in terms of the development within the community, do you have people who are actually interacting and transacting Steam back and forth?
Yeah, they're sure all the time.
But for content acquisition purposes?
Well, the way we, yes and no. For example, one site had implemented a tipping feature. Technically, anytime I upload a piece of content, I am sending them Steam. It's valuable Steam. Now what we do is we basically hide the fees and the friction by having the token go not from my wallet to their wallet, but from new token inflation to their wallet. So you're still paying. We're paying as a network, but it doesn't feel like it's coming out of my wallet. Instead, we're using new token creation to spur economic growth.
Now, in terms of, if we go back, obviously, Divi's gotten this started, so you've got your community size of 100 masternodes so far. So hopefully we'll be seeing up to 1,000 and then up to 100,000 fairly soon. What's your own expectation in terms of your ramp as you're looking at
as far as community goes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I really enjoy the community aspect of our coin. We built our coin and our blockchain around the community, with the community in mind. And it's grown pretty quickly over the past, even just the past month, we've probably added 1,500 to 2,000 people to our community on Telegram or what have you. But what we find is that because we offer these different levels of masternodes, so we have 5 masternode opportunities, right? Mochi opportunities. And we find that because each level allows for a higher reward, or rate of reward, it gamifies the entire ecosystem. And people start seeing how much they can generate and see if they can gamify or game the system to get to the next level. That is one aspect of our community, but we've also built the blockchain to be dynamic. So we built these things called dynamic value scores. And essentially what it allows for is changes to the blockchain based on a governance vote. So if I want the block time to change, if I think that the rate of return is too high, we can propose that change, and that can be changed pretty much instantaneously, assuming the vote is successful in that direction. As far as ramping that up, I think that our community is very grassroots, always has been. We've never paid, YouTube shills and stuff like that. We have used Steam quite a bit, though, and I really respect Steam. I think you guys are great. And we will continue to access that community, the people that are already, say, bullish on cryptocurrency, that understand the opportunity that we're providing and that can go out and explain why this is a great alternative to some of the side hustles that they're probably already doing right now.
Sure. Thomas, in terms of your community that you've been building in Sodom.
Yeah, so we have a pretty strong community within blockchain, unfortunately, in that respect. But we're getting ready to launch some campaigns where we can build a larger kind of general populace community. And that is going to be through a USB stick, where essentially you'll be able to put the USB stick into the computer and it will boot into a mode where it can start contributing resources to the network. So it's very easy, very kind of non-technical. And so those campaigns are going to be really going underway in the first quarter of next year. The USB sticks will begin distribution in the next month or so. But yeah, we have really strong community managers as well, that are very active from the investment side. And so now we're looking to grow more of the resource contributor community within our network.
Okay, great. Let's see, just real quick, if you kind of run through, talk about what do you think are the 3 major challenges you're going to have in terms of growing your business from here? If we'll go through the panel, Andrew, if you want to take a shot at that.
The 3 biggest challenges. Well, number one is that blockchain development, you have to add a scaling factor to how long you think it's going to take, which can be anywhere from 10x to 30x. So just developing software is a huge thing. Now, we have an advantage of having an existing product and having the experience of updating that and upgrading that, but it's something every blockchain team needs to bear in mind, is that if you think it's going to take a month, it's going to take 2 years. the second one that we're struggling with, but we're really the only ones, is that we're growing incredibly fast. Because basically, there are all these apps that enable anybody to share content on our blockchain. And if you share the right content, you can make money. And what the consequence of that is extremely rapid growth. And that's why we have so many transactions. We're the most used blockchain by far. We have the most apps that real people use every day. And so when you factor in the first problem of building out your stack and making it really scalable, those two things combined to making it a high-pressure scenario. That's why, despite being the most used blockchain, you might not have even heard of us, because we're too busy like building at the base level. We just did our 20th hard fork. There are no sister chains of Steam, so we've upgraded. Becoming a mature organization, I think that's one of the most overlooked things because most of the organizations that are in here are so decentralized and so young, but we've been in the space for 2 years. We started at about 70 people. I came on at about that time, and we're now around 50 people. And you know, scaling is about a lot more than transaction speed. Going from 7 employees to 20 employees to 50 employees, each one of those is a step in change. And the entire organization has to evolve and adapt with that. And I think that's, you know, you managed to get your blockchain play off the ground, get funded, all that. I mean, he's probably struggling with the same stuff. And then you realize that just growing an organization is a whole new challenge.
As organizations, by their own nature, tend to be centralized, but you're operating in a decentralized setting. So from that standpoint, there's a bit of a contradiction inherent within that.
Well, so one of the ways we work that out is that Steam Inc. is the company that I work for. You know, we're funded by Steam. We have an initial bunch of Steam that we got, but we are an incorporated corporation in the United States, in the state of Delaware, and we are tasked with generating open source code. And we basically use the Steam that we have to generate that code, which then has to get approved by the 20 witnesses, who are kind of like master nodes, but there can only be 20. That's how the system's efficiency is achieved through that. So we have an interesting kind of governance model where it's delegated proof of stake, which you can look into, and we are this separate entity, but we're all bound together through our holding of Steam.
Sure.
So we really all work for the Steam blockchain. We just happen to be a corporation at the core of it.
Something that EOS wasn't really able to handle easily, getting out of the blocks. Managed to solve that problem. Congratulations.
For now, I mean, you know, we're trying. We're not trying to, you know, be overconfident, but our strategy is based on an application-specific framework where we're not trying to be a general-purpose protocol, and we think that gives us certain advantages, and including with respect to EOS. But when you're trying to be everything, it's really hard to do anything particularly well, even governance.
Good point. So, Divi.
Yeah, I think probably the biggest challenge for blockchain, or cryptocurrency, I should say, not so much blockchain. I think blockchain is going to integrate with most enterprise-level technologies at some point, especially, you know, within healthcare and obviously, tracking of products and stuff like that along the supply chain. It makes perfect sense. Cryptocurrency is more difficult to garner adoption because, first of all, a lot of people don't quite understand it. How many people in here have actually used cryptocurrency in the real world? Okay, that's more than usual. That was like four. Getting to the point where people, A, feel comfortable using it, because if you've ever sent a cryptocurrency transaction, you know that it can relatively daunting the first time. You have these long streams of numbers and letters, you're in all these different accounts, and you're pressing send, and you're not sure if it's gonna go to the right place. I think, what is it, something like 20% of all the Bitcoin has been lost in user error. And people know these facts, and they hear them all the time on TV and stuff. So getting to a point where people feel comfortable and familiarized with utilizing cryptocurrency, that's a big challenge. That's something that we're trying to solve by implementing things like human-readable addresses. So instead of having a crazy string of numbers and letters, you have an email address or what have you. We're not the only people doing that, and it's good to see. It's good to see that more cryptocurrencies are taking the user experience more seriously, because until we are a viable alternative to what's being used right now, it just won't be. Now, of course, adoption's easier in places like Venezuela where, you know, inflation destroys their currency. But the U.S. and other first world nations, it will be harder to garner adoption that way. So empowering developers and individuals to create things that are, like I said, viable alternatives, that's going to be, in my opinion, that's the key to bridging the gap between.
Excellent. Thomas?
So for
For us, it's really because at the heart of our platform, we have fog computing and blockchain. And these are two kind of leading edge technologies. I'm just curious, who has heard of fog computing? Okay. So essentially, with fog computing, there are some requirements for companies to even adopt it. So without getting too technical, there's a thing called containers that you can put your applications in that kind of allow it to work on top of an infrastructure a little bit more agnostically. And so we have to align with where the industry is and where companies are with adopting some of these prerequisites and become champions for these kind of technologies. So for us, it's really about, you know, cultivating awareness around the set of technology and the benefits of fog computing. Let's see, I would say that's our biggest challenge. I think, you know, operationally, you know, also scaling. When I joined the company, we were at about 20 employees last October, and then now we're over 75. You know, so it's similar to dealing on a global basis and how do we localize the messages within markets and really foster a community within each country that we're focusing on.
Great. So Thomas, if I could, I'd like to kind of, since we've gone through and we've looked at some of your challenges are and how things are scaling, how you're working in the community, I guess in terms of looking at it from the perspective of someone who's going to invest the time and effort to build a side hustle using your products, using your services, you know, what can you tell people who are out in the audience and sort of say, look, you can come and invest the time with us, we're going to be here for the long haul. And, you know, can you give us a sense of sort of like how you look at that sort of value proposition that you're offering to people who are looking at you and considering you for the first time and thinking about sort of, should I basically build my side up off of some, you know, what's the pitch?
Yes, so are you talking about from the like everyday person who's contributing resources?
Well, you know, committing time and resources.
Yeah.
I mean, time's obviously the scarce resource we all work with,
yeah.
So from that standpoint. If someone says, look, I'm interested in terms of what's being proposed by Sonam or by Divi or by Steam, you know, I'm going to make the commitment from
sure.
their side. Obviously, people, as they enter into that kind of situation, they want to have some sense that this is something that if they build it, it's going to last.
Yeah. Okay, so I would say that the easiest way to frame that would be when you look at mining cryptocurrency, which is obviously profitable enough for all the people doing it, with Sonam, you're guaranteed to make that. What happens, as I mentioned earlier, there's this computational task arbitrage, which essentially means that there's a bot, and it will be looking at the marketplace for a match, and you're going to be, you know, mining the most profitable cryptocurrency at that moment until this task comes in. And then enterprises, instead of like mining, where you may complete a block faster, like 1 out of 8 times, with the enterprise task, they're paying you for every cycle. So the amount of money that you're making is going to be exponentially greater than just mining cryptocurrency. So the value proposition is if you have your computer sitting at your house, if you have unused computers in your company, or if you have some kind of dedicated resource in a co-location facility, we can monetize that unused resources that you have, and we can monetize the resources that you have when you're not using them. So if you're sleeping, if you're at school, if you're on a trip, these are all ways for you to make extra money. And so we're focusing on you know, these different categories of suppliers in different ways, but for students, you know, when they're in class or on a trip or going back home or away for the summer, you know, they have the opportunity to monetize that. Also gamers. Gamers is another quality resource because it has you know, hard drive space, memory, video cards. It's, you know, kind of a balanced system. So the value proposition is fundamentally the same, but perhaps greater to some of the segments.
Okay.
Well, I think you made a good point, a valuable point, in that time is our most valuable resource, right? And we see people picking up side hustles for basically one of two reasons. The first reason is probably the most prescient, which is the fact that jobs don't pay enough and that you need to make more money than you make. The second being people want to take control over their time because clocking in, clocking out, especially for the younger generation, seems to be less desirable. If you people are trying to find ways that they can still earn an income, still have the lifestyle that they want at the same time. So with Divi, because we enable you to quickly and easily set up a computer program that earns you money, essentially, that you can close, walk away from, you don't actually have to run your computer at all, you can deploy it to the cloud, and you can just come back whenever you want and see your earnings. That type of freedom in terms of time management, I think, is extremely valuable, and the reason that a lot of people come to us looking for that type of opportunity. It's also a really good way to hedge against the market. We see how the market turned around at the beginning of the year, and a lot of people, even I know people that quit their jobs trying to become crypto traders full time, and of course, that's not going to work out anymore. So by doing something like minting or mining or running a computer program or blogging for additional income, you actually hedge against those potential losses that you may have incurred over the course of a bear market.
So Andrew, I'm going to have to be a little unfair. To the extent that you've basically pretty well defined your value proposition with the adoption that you've seen, where do you see things evolving from the standpoint of competitive perspective? Do you see anybody else out there who's trying to put something up that could rival Steam?
Honestly, you really have to strain the imagination to, you know, there are people who've been saying that they're going to for a long time. Unfortunately, we really don't have anybody to look at, which we really don't like, because we're an open source project and we love open source technology. And we're always looking at other open source projects for stuff we can take. Like one of the things, so for example, I mentioned our smart media tokens protocol, and not to get into the weeds, but we're including in that protocol a similar algorithm to what Bancor did with automated market makers. And so we use open source code that's out there. We're not afraid of competition. Unfortunately, what we're seeing is that the field is still shaking out, and that, I mean, people aren't going after being an application-specific base layer protocol geared at content creators. And so, until I see that, I'm going to be like, no, we don't have competitors, because we're hyper-focused on that. We're 2 years ahead, and as long as I'm not seeing white papers that are saying, first of all, if you're writing white papers, join us in 2018. That's no longer cool. But yeah, so, you know, I think our biggest threat is our own inability to continue innovating and continue breaking through our bottlenecks. Like, so our next, two of our next big plays are the tokens that I mentioned, but also a community's product. You know, so you can look at Steemit as one enormous community, and it's very noisy because it's so big. And that's why when I say we have 1 million accounts and 60,000 daily active accounts, the astute observer might say, oh, that's not the greatest engagement. It's good for blockchain, but it's not ideal. And that's where communities comes into play. And we want to enable projects like these guys, like you, but you and you, and you, whoever has a community, whoever has a community that they want to incentivize, that's what we're building now. And so, in a, our position is that if we fail to deliver that, we will have failed. We need to deliver on that, because Steam just isn't scaling, not on a technical level, on a social level. You know, every one of these people in here has to be able to find a community for them where they can come in and contribute something of value. Humans are inherently creative organisms, and we're trying to give them as many outlets as possible. So if you go to steamprojects.com, that's a third-party site that just maintains all the different apps that are running on Steam, and you can use those today to start generating additional revenue. Again, not by running a computer. That's not what we're trying to enable you to do. We're trying to enable you to access sites for free that enable you to contribute valuable content. There's an app called Steep Shot. It's an Instagram competitor. Can you take a photo of yourself? Can you make it look good? You can earn tokens based on that. You can earn real tokens worth real money today on that. But in order for it to really scale, we need to deliver smart media tokens are effectively community tokens. So if you're an Instagrammer with a large community, you need to be able to set up your community, and you need to be able to launch your own currency, your own money. Because it's on Steam, it's going to travel in 3 seconds, and it's going to be feeless. So you're going to immediately get a money that's better than the US dollar. But we have to finish building it, and we have to launch it so that any ordinary person can do it. Like he said, we are going after the same audience in different ways of making sure that anybody in here can sign up, and launch a token at a community.
You raise a very good point, engaging the audience, which is what I'd like to do now. Can we take some questions from the audience? It's enough of us talking. Let's hear what you guys have to say. Is there a microphone that can be passed around? Meanwhile, you're giving Mark Zuckerberg my
I wish. We couldn't handle the volume that, one 100th of their users. I mean, we're trying to build a platform that will deliver the next wave, but, as advanced as we are, we're still years away from handling that level of volume,
Is there a question out there?
And I think we have to focus on value for that reason, high quality, because we can't take every human.
No, of course not.
Yeah, now this is one of my questions is what's the biggest challenge in terms of the longevity of what you're building? Because if someone's going to invest the time and effort to say, hey, I'm going to build a Steam account, I'm going to build a Mastermind with Divi, I'm going to build a cloud computer with Sonam, and you invest that time and then all of a sudden it either goes away or it's not sustainable or you're not seeing as much return on your time, how are you guys thinking about that?
Well, I would say go with the oldest project.
So, I can answer that from the Sonam's perspective. So, all of this is done through a decentralized offering and through smart contracts. And ultimately, our goal is to have this kind of float out there where we couldn't even shut it down if we wanted to, in a way, so that this would exist in an autonomous fashion. So if you built your app on top of it, very small chance that it would actually stop working.
Yeah, similarly, pretty much with any open source blockchain, we've seen how far Bitcoin has come with just the influence of other developers that have nothing to do with the inception of the protocol. As long as there are a couple nodes connected, it exists, even if we don't, right? And I think that's pretty much true with, you can say that about almost any, open source blockchain at this point. They're all decentralized and autonomous. Ours maybe even more so because of the decentralized governance system that can make changes without a hard fork. It doesn't require even the influence of a developer in order to make changes as long as the vote goes through. So, yeah.
So, I would say that for us, we are extremely passionate and driven toward empowering content creators of all kinds. That's our application-specific design. We've been doing it for 2 years. We all work insanely hard. There's tons of documentation about what we're doing. There's tons of apps that show off what our technology can do. And if you look into the projects that are built on our platform, if you look into our project and you get excited about what we're doing, then we're eager to have you participate with us, and our stakeholders will be eager to reward you. And I don't think you should be, don't try to be the person who's predicting what's going to survive and what's going to die. Nobody can do that. That's not possible. But what you can do is invest your time and your energy and your attention into projects that you believe in, that you're passionate about, that get you excited. And if you are excited about something, then other people will be excited about it. And if you're not excited about what we're doing, I really couldn't care less. I just won't want to work with you. It's fine. Go do something else, That's okay. But if you're excited about what we're doing, then I will help you as much as I possibly can, and so will the rest of our community.
Yeah, there's a ton of projects out there, right? And a ton of teams, and a lot of the teams are very inexperienced. A lot of the coins are just shit coins. Sorry, I'm not allowed to say that, but and it's pretty easy to tell nowadays because we had a huge boom of projects come out, and almost none of them delivered on anything they said. A lot of them raised $100 million, and they're nowhere to be found, right? So, Divi, we like I said, been a grassroots project from the very beginning. We only raised $3.5 million. And we were able to spin our own chain in less than a year. And we're still going strong, and we're still building that community every single day. It's really, like Andrew said, about a team. Look at the team that you're investing in, or that you're trying to contribute to, because without the, like you say, without the passion, it's dead on arrival.
Thomas?
So, well, I'm sorry, what was the question? I thought about that first.
If anybody wants to, I just went twice. Now, the question was sort of a rephrasing of what was asked earlier, which was more in terms of, you know, people making the commitment and providing some idea of longevity.
So yeah, I talked about the decentralized, autonomous nature of the platform.
Okay. Any other questions?
Sure. I guess one of the biggest questions I get confronted with a lot of blockchain, cryptocurrencies, and applications is around growth and scalability to the general consumers and public. You guys have mentioned several times that Steam is predicated on a growing community. How do you, what do you think the biggest barrier is to be able to grow into a more general market? And what do you think is necessary to get there when most people can't even wrap, when most people can't even separate Bitcoin from blockchain? How do you get the general market awareness for what to do and make it digestible in a way where they feel comfortable using it?
Yeah, I think our answer to that is that you power applications that ordinary people just want to use. Like DTube, for example, D.tube, check it out. I think it answers that question really well. Like YouTubers find it every day because they get demonetized and they search decentralized YouTube. And they go to DTube and they don't even know they're using Steam. They don't know that when they create that account, they're getting a Steam account that actually enables them to use any other app. And then they go through a chain and go, well, I can use this app, I can use Steam Shot, I can log on steam.com, and it's all the same sign-on. They're using Steam, but they got onboarded in an organic way. I mean, I have no doubt that we onboard orders of magnitude more ordinary people every day than any other blockchain exists, because we onboard people. It's not the biggest thing. Now, with respect to scalability, the biggest constraint, the fundamental constraint, is that decentralized solutions are always going to be less efficient than their centralized competitors. That will never change, ever. I will die, and that will be true. Like I said before, our solution to that is being extremely obsessive about the application-specific nature of our blockchain. Our blockchain store is essentially two things. It's a decentralized content management system. It stores account names, posts, comments, votes, on chain. You can look at the chain, you can see usernames, like he kind of alluded to. You can see usernames, you can see text-based posts, and then you can see token transfers. And a certain number of those token transfers are moderated by the upvotes and downvotes of the community themselves. And the fact that there are no smart contracts. You cannot create variable computational costs on our blockchain to get all the little nerdy, sorry. And that enables us to continue offering a freemium blockchain because we know exactly how much load users can put on. We know how much, as a community, they should be allowed to do for free, and that's maintained in a decentralized way. But basically, you have to be able to sign up for free, you have to be able to begin using the stuff for free. But at the same time, the stack has to be able to scale, and so by focusing on just a few core functionalities that we believe are the foundation of every web application, that's how you scale. The limited nature of, what site doesn't have posts, what site doesn't have account names, uploads and downloads. Every site has either these or the equivalents of these, and everything else you can do on your own. And then we just provide you with the API calls that you need to power your web interface. If you don't want to use any of the theme apps that exist, just build a web interface using your ordinary web development tools, and then use our APIs to call our backend as a database. Sorry, I rambled on.
I think I may be biased in this answer a little bit, but I think adoption is inevitable. The immense irresponsibility of the governments of the world with the financial resources that we're required to give them becomes more apparent every day. The immense irresponsibility of tech companies with our data becomes more apparent every single day. Ownership of your money and of your data, who you are, is going to become more and more important and more apparent that it's not being owned by the people each and every day. And blockchain and cryptocurrency enable average people to take back control of themselves and stop letting huge companies build profiles on you based on your behavior and the things you say near your phone, and allowing companies to hold your funds because they're not sure why you're sending them. I'm not going to mention any payment processing companies, two P's, but they're out there, right? Again, cryptocurrency enables us to take back that control, and it's just a matter of time and a little bit of education before people start to catch on. And with amazing companies creating things that are viable alternatives and easier to use, it will only happen quicker.
We're running short on time, so I'm going to Thomas.
So to me, I think it comes down to user interfaces and making a more traditional experience within the applications that we build. I think that the second aspect to scalability, to me, with Sonom is utilizing APIs and the advent of Internet of Things, where these devices are going to be communicating and doing microtransactions back and forth, and may require additional computational resources that they can spin up on demand using our platform.
Great. Well, look, I want to thank everybody for participating. So, Thomas, Nick, Andrew.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
So, Sona, Divi, Steve, we want to thank you for your vision, your energy, your creativity, and your commitment to basically making the blockchain happen. Thank you.
Thanks.